And then all of a sudden that stopped. We had dates in the diary for about 6 months and it just stopped. I'm not saying that that's reason to refer it to the Secretary of State, but I do think that that consultation was nowhere near adequate. As they left us sort of in limbo land as to how people were going to get to our heart hospital, never mind sort of at 7 o'clock at night when the buses stopped, but at 10, 11 o'clock at night. When it's the middle of the night, you're not going to go and knock on a neighbour's door. So what are you going to do? You're going to call an ambulance. And that's the last thing we want to happen. So I'm very concerned about the consultation regarding public transport.
I want to agree with Mary over that, because I just gave up on it, because I could see it was just some sort of exercise, especially as the companies that run the buses weren't involved in the discussions, and those who travel themselves have said they can't control what they do, and we now see that because we've got these extra buses going on. And I think we also have a problem with incentive empathy, because if the two's taken off, that's one of the major buses from Asbury Port to going into Easton. So that's difficult for them, because the X bus, which they're kind of pushing, doesn't stop, just about stops in Easton. Yeah, so that's not an easy situation, because we don't have any control of the transport. I also think, possibly because we had the same discussion with them last week, that we're a bit of a non-situation, aren't we? Because we can't stop anything that they're going to do on the 9th of July. And so where do we talk to them before they announce it? At what point do we talk to them about the proposals, the bits that we might not agree with?
2028.
When it looks like they're going to get this thing set up pretty quickly.
My understanding on that is that we talk to them after their decision on the 9th of July, and we talked to them from our adult scrutiny meeting that follows that. But bear in mind, Wirral's adult scrutiny does not have the power to make a referral to the Secretary of State, which is a disjoint group. So just bear that in mind.
I think I'd just like to echo.
It seems to me that increasingly centralising urgent care and primary care services in one location, which it seems to be what's happening, seems to go absolutely fly in the face of actually what primary care is about, which is access, 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 and delivering services as close to where people live as you possibly can. I do think that the kind of services that GPs offer is very different to the kind of services that urgent care offer. GPs tend to be very good at stitching people up. They haven't done it since they trained. They're not very good at dealing with urgent care. Their strengths are in managing people's long-term conditions, in delivering that continuity that people were concerned about. And it seems to me that, yes, they can act as a backup with some of the urgent care, but to my mind, you deliver services where people are, not where you want them to go.
So I'm just wondering, it's obviously different in Wirral because you're obviously covered by Mersey Travel.
don't have the luxury of a transport authority, so this will be doing itself. But what our staff at the council are actually quite good at is working in partnership with transport providers. Now, we all know the delights of trying to engage with bus operators. The one thing that bus operators are always quite keen on is passengers. So I'm just wondering, I think I made a point earlier on about trying to understand why it is that people go to some of the locations that they choose to go to on age 15. Because if we understood why they went there as opposed to somewhere else in the configuration of service opportunities, we might actually be able to bring about some community transport planning. So when you're actually booking your appointment, it's not beyond the wit of man that we could actually run some, NHS consultation, but just somebody sitting in GP practice going, do you mind me asking where you come from today? Because what we're trying to do is we're trying to make sure that those services, and particularly in the commissioning environment, if people are having to travel for, pick a service, it might be that we can actually inform better commissioning decisions that actually you really do need to put that sort of service in this location, because otherwise you've got people travelling all over the place. And I don't know about you, but we've just declared a climate emergency, so we're very keen on the carbon footprint. So what is it that we're going to do to try and, because if we're cutting down the carbon footprint, we're actually really helping patients to access things that are nearer to them. Because if I don't have to get in the car, and drive 20 miles to the urgent care centre, and I can access that service around the corner in the local walking centre, that's better for me. It's also better for your highways department and your carbon footprint, your air quality and everything else. So it's about taking a bit more of a holistic partnership approach to some of these issues, I think. But should we come back, sorry, putting the thing to me, or should we actually come back as a joint scrutiny committee and say, if this is going live on the 1st of April to 2020, do we get together in a few months' time when there's 6 months to go and actually have a look at how much progress they've made about some of the things that we talked about today? I think there might be some mileage in keeping the pressure on them and saying, we could refer it to the Secretary of State, but we all want to see delivery for our residents, but we absolutely want to make sure that we deliver on what the consultation has told us.
Raised at our working party on transport that
why I think a number of people, and certainly members of the public, are concerned that any of the sentences would not be there anymore, because it absolutely ties in with what you're saying. These are the sentences that people use because they are part of the communities that they live in, and they then don't have to travel so far. And it's fine if there is money for taxis, but I think you might find that in some areas, if you call for a taxi to say you want to go to Iron Park Hospital and it's an emergency, they won't take you because they're worried that you're going to mess their taxi. I only say this because that's one of my residents said that's exactly what happened to an elderly frail lady. Said that they just said no, they didn't really want to take the risk. Said they have no taxis available. So, as I say, it's very difficult because we've seen like half a promised land, haven't we, here? But we haven't, and I'm mindful as I'm looking at words up there that say, hands off more than a new ferry. Which don't come into this paperwork here. And I hear what Dr. Cllr said about GPs and everything else. But I know in my own practice, which is part of, I think, the same federation as she's in, because I get on rules now, you can't get appointments. There's a shortage of doctors. So I think it's a very, very different case. If, say, I've got one of my grandchildren and they have an accident, not terribly bad, but I feel, in my opinion, it needs a second opinion on whether there's a break or whatever. I would want to go to Eastern Walking Centre. I would want to go to a GP. I have a daughter who's a GP, and she says to me, don't ask me, I've never trained in emergency medicine. When I say to her, do you think this is broken or not, holding child's arm upon Sky? As well as saying, for God's sake, mother, why don't you find somebody to tell you? Why ask me? But I just think somehow there's this blurring, and my heart always sinks when I hear somebody tell me about some American system that's coming our way, where we've got this new people who are physician magicians, physician assistants. How on earth are people going to know who can do what and what where they're supposed to go? They talk to us about people being confused about which walking centre to go to. And I had to say to them at the time, I've never met anybody who's confused about which walking centre to go to. Shows these people, because I've never heard of them. But I think people would be confused when they heard physician's assistant, because it implies that you're dealing with a doctor. And even the word physician somehow suggests that. So I'm uneasy about all this, but I think at this late stage, I don't know whether we can take the step of going to the Secretary of State.
Well, the short answer is we can, if that's what we decide to do. So that's very simple. What we do have other options, though, than that. We can make recommendations that we can ask the Joint Commissioning body to consider. We can wait until they reach their decision, and then we consider not only whether the consultation is adequate, but whether or not proposals meet the needs of everybody. So you can actually then look at both. And if we're going to do that, I would suggest that we don't wait 6 months to meet again. I would suggest that we meet as soon as practical after that decision has been announced. Because then if we decide we do want to, though, that may well be the point. I mean, I share many of the concerns about the consultation. The first thing that I concern that I have about the consultation is the fact that it's a consultation based on the decision that's already taken. The decision to actually have an urgent care treatment centre had already been taken. And all the people were consulted about was, what do you want it to look like? So it wasn't actually consultation about whether that was what people wanted. I appreciate that we were asked not to discuss tonight and not to make a part of the deliberations of this committee about the proposals, but you know, we can't pretend that we don't know what they are. And like everybody like a council at the moment. I'm very well aware that people in those areas are highly disadvantaged and are very much have cars, whether they get to by public transport. So yes, I share a lot of the concerns that have been expressed tonight. So it's whether or not we decide that we would like to consider after the announcement of the proposals, whether we'd like to come back together to consider what the views of this joint scrutiny actually are in respect of the final proposals. Councillor Riley and then Councillor Seacombe.
Thank you, Chair. I think probably you'll be picking up a sort of mood music around probably convening after the decision has been made. Whether the scrutiny function is this sort of layout and format is the right format for that, I don't know, because I think we've had quite an encouraging session tonight, but I would want to get into a lot more detail around what does this actually mean and what does it look like. And I don't know sometimes whether scrutiny is the best way to get into that or whether it's an informal meeting of the scrutiny function to get into that. I don't know, I'll be guided by you. I do come back to the fact, however, that I probably have a little bit more confidence about the proposals. I just think they've been really badly described. So I think we can all, understand the logic behind, the report itself, it details how, what percentage of people are presenting at A&E, who don't necessarily need to be there. That's the only place that they can go to. So having something that takes the pressure off those services that we can all accept are there for, those in greatest life-threatening need or people who are seriously ill, as opposed to people who need urgent care, it just needs thinking through in terms of how it's described and, as Dr. Cowan said, how it's presented to us. And there are some amazing models up and down the UK where people, and I say this with love and respect, don't have the traditional receptionist on the front line. They actually have a clinician on the front line who's making medical assessment as to where I am best to go for what I'm presenting with. And it's not my decision as to whether I choose a GP or choose something else, because I'm always going to choose a GP because I've been raised when I'm poorly that I go to see the doctor. I don't want to see anybody else because I don't know what they are and I don't understand it. But I will take the advice of somebody who's clinically trained saying the best treatment for you today, Lynn, is to go and see the nurse practitioner who can absolutely help you without children going for follow-up appointments. It's all reassuring of personalised care. So I do agree with Dr. Cowan that it's how it's done rather than what is being done. And that's my criticism of the health service. It always focuses on the what rather than the why. Because I think I get the logic, but how it's presented is, driving me to sign a petition to say absolutely not, because you've not described it well enough.
I'm a little bit like you, I'm not convinced about the architecture of this proposal. I would be guided as to which side of that decision would be best. I don't know if there are pros and cons about making that clear now or making that clear afterwards. I mean, I totally agree with the Councillor Riley about innovation and the way we, service delivered, marketing. Totally, but I have concerns about the underlying architecture, and I agree with you that it was presented a bit hyper.
Perhaps I think just clarify again the options that we have, because there are two areas in which we can refer to the state, which are appropriate.
Yes, members can refer to the Secretary of State if you're not satisfied that the consultation with the relevant health scrutiny arrangements on the proposal has been adequate. And you can also refer to the Secretary of State if you do not consider the proposal would be in the interests of the health service in the area. members can make recommendations to health. The CCG are obliged to consider your recommendations and to try to enter into negotiations with the members to resolve the issues that you're raising with them. And then you can also refer to the Secretary of State if there has been an attempt to reach agreement, but that has not happened within a reasonable time scale, or if there has been no attempt to reach agreement with you in relation to the issues that you disagree about. So it's an ask for members whether you want to make referral or indicate to health you want to make referrals at this stage, or you want to flag up your concerns, your recommendations, and seek further views into some negotiations in relation to those issues.
It would seem to me, and I'm happy to be open to discussion on this, it would seem to me that if we do decide to go down that route of making referral to the Secretary of State, it will be stronger if we make it knowing the proposals. So I think there's that. I also think that we can at this point make a recommendation that we would ask the Joint Commissioning Board to consider at their meeting on the 9th of July. And I would suggest that, and I'm perfectly sure that Katrina and Patrick are picking up on what the right words, but it is that we ask them to reconsider the consultation process around transport and access to any revised arrangements, given that we are aware that plans and by the bus operators have changed since this went out to consultation, which they have considerably. Proposals to scrap some buses that actually do go at the tariff parts and leave. So I would suggest that we ask them to reconsider their consultation around transport, and to reconsider how that impacts on their proposals. And I would also be inclined to recommend that they retain all of the current urgent care arrangements.
Absolutely. So thank you, Chair. I just want to make two quick points to our colleagues from Cheshire West that they may not be aware of. Factor fees that are given on all the walking centres are not really level playing field because they offer different services. So one of the questions my colleague here mentioned about travelling to where to get what result. If I had to take my daughter going from Councillor Muspratt's analogy to see if she got a broken arm, I would take her to VCH because they've got X-ray department there, which they don't have in Eastham. So if we had an X-ray department in Eastham, and we had the services in Eastham that they had in others, then that would even that out. The other point I would like to make, to make them aware of, is there was also mention of these out of hours and extra GP appointments throughout the whole of Wirral. My understanding that the different clusters of GPs are actually at war with each other. They're not friendly at all. So they're not. They gave the impression that they were all collating everything and all happy, and they're far from it. So they're two points I think really need to be remembered. Thank you, Chair.
So if we were to go down that route of making those recommendations to the Joint Commissioning Board on the 9th of July, we would need to follow that up as soon as practically possible following that meeting with another joint meeting and to see what responses have been made to our recommendations and then to consider our position from there. You've got words.
Sorry, Ben, just be difficult to just. I've been taking copious notes of everything, because I'm sure Patrick has. And there are clearly a number of very key factors that members have brought to the surface during the discussion. I think we captured those during the discussion. It seems to be appropriate if we can find a form of words for you, convey to the CCB government board your significant concerns over the consultation so far, but also making it abundantly clear that we want to know very clearly what the new model is and have the opportunity to comment on that model and how, for example, it affects the most disadvantaged people in our respective authorities, how it demonstrates, for example, that the outcome of the consultation has been properly taken into account, to show in fact that they've listened and how they listened and what the outcome is. If we may, we can form a set of series of points, if you like, for you to say, look, we considered this carefully, you've only let us consider it up to a point, but so far these are the points that we really do want to make, and please take this into account during your consideration of it. And if they're not taken into account, you're not satisfied with that, at that point then you can take it forward to the Secretary of State and say, well, we said this, but would you have a better proper outcome from it?
Quite happy to go along with what you say, but can we add to disadvantage? Can we add isolated?
Meetings are two online. Yeah, so we can watch.